So, in the following video, I'm gonna show you what I used for the repair of the rear left brake on my BMW i3. And you currently see a video where I go through all the tools. And yeah, I'm shortly gonna catch up with that. Currently, I'm pointing at the metal free compound. After that, this is the torque wrench. You need to torque it to 140 newton meters. I also use the hammer, hand screw thing, a pipe wrench. That's what I'm currently showing here, or trying to show. I think I was actually thinking about what the name of a pipe wrench was. Then I use sandpaper, it's 120 grit, a small flathead screwdriver, two different wrenches, one is half inch and one is a thing that actually can just receive a half inch steel thing. This is my breaker bar, it also can receive the half inch steel thing that also fits in the nuts. We hit it with the hammer and you need a thing like this for the repair job. You can also see the crowbar and the piece of foam there that's to store the lug nuts. On wrenches you need, or on sockets I would say, you need different extensions. One is 7, one's about 14 or 12 centimeters long. And then you need a 6mm hex or Allen bit and a 7mm hex or Allen bit. Then you need a 17mm outer bit for removing your lug nuts and E18 Torx, also outer bit or nut, for removing two big bolts that hold on the brake caliper holder. You also need a wire brush and a wheel cross and some C-clamps to, as you can see here, fixate your car, because you don't have, you need to release the parking brake so you don't have a brake then, and it's kind of dangerous to jack up your car without a brake. Therefore, you also put a piece of wood under your car once you jacked it up, and you fixate both of the tires, as you can see here, on both sides. You do that with the front tires. Yeah, we also used a new brake rotor and new brake pads, some WD-40 and a piece of combination pliers. So first step is to remove your lug nuts, and you can see that here. Remove the lug nuts while the car is still standing on the ground. After that, jack up the car and remove them all. Get off the wire. The wheel. As you can see here, I show you where the sensor sits. There's a brake wear sensor. It's on the other side and it sits right in that groove in the brake caliper. So it's on the right side. Then you remove the anti-vibration spring. You can buy new ones, you can also reuse the old ones. These actually look quite good, but we bought new ones anyways. The next step is to remove two plastic protection plugs that sit on the sliding pin holders that hold the brake caliper to the carrying cage. You're gonna see me here removing them with a flathead screwdriver, and that's one of them. after this you use your 7mm hex on a ratchet, and yeah, try to get it in there and try to move the ratchet actually in the right way. As you can see now, I'm actually moving it in the wrong way, because my father set me to set the ratchet to the wrong direction and threw me that way. So I was a bit weirded out here, and I think I sweared a bit. Now I changed the ratchet to the right direction, and as you can see, it fits in nicely. And then these things are actually fairly tight, but then easy to remove. The lower one is a bit tricky because there's a piece of steel supporting the axle, and it's quite hard to remove. I think I'm gonna show that in the next shot. And you need to be a bit creative there with your combinations of different sockets and extensions to get the thing removed. I'm still struggling with this, eh? Come on, you can do it. Or maybe it's the wrong clip, I don't know. Yeah, I think I inserted this clip twice. So, yeah. Not that good. But I can see some change coming in a few seconds. And after this you can push the pin out with a flathead screwdriver if it's stuck. Sometimes it's a bit stuck, but make sure to unscrew it fully first, so you don't mar up the last thread. Later you need to polish these pins, because the brake caliper actually floats on them and realigns with them. So you need to polish them, and I think that's gonna be the next shot. Polish these pins. As you can see, we polish them, and while polishing you slowly turn them, but yeah, use your wire brush for this. It's not that hard, and don't look at the bench. It's not tidy. But after this, the pin was really polished, so hey, quite nice. This is the lower one. As you can see, there's this bar holding on to the wheel hub, and it's actually sort of in the way. You could push up the wheel up with a jack, and then the bar would go down a bit, and that would be helpful to remove it. Now I have removed that bolt, and now you can remove the wheel, the caliper, with a crowbar. And you do that by just pressing in the crowbar at the top and then wiggling a bit. See, I press it in at the top, I wiggle it free, and then you can just lift off the brake caliper. Now you put your crowbar away somewhere where you can easily get it for your next job. next step is to... okay, now I'm gonna go over the dimensions of the brake piston. It has two indentations, 180 degrees apart, and you actually need to turn it, I think you need to turn it clockwise to push it back in. Well, that's because the parking brake turns the piston to apply the parking brake. And yeah, that's how it works. And these dimensions, so there's a special piston pushback tool and it needs to fit in both of these holes to turn the piston while pushing it back. And the outer diameter is, as you can see, 33 millimeters. Or 1.3 inches. The inner diameter is 23 millimeters. Or 0.9 inches. So this is the tool that you need to push back the brake piston, and you turn the handle anti-clockwise and tighten up the pushback nut all the time while you push it back. Unfortunately, this is very hard to film and do at the same time, so I have no footage of this. But you're gonna need to live with that, I think. And by the way, both of the brakes on the rear, it's clockwise to push back the piston. When you push back the piston the whole way, you're gonna clearly feel it bottom out. It's a hard stop. And the piston should turn fairly easy. There are some people on Amazon that say they bend these tools, and I don't know what they do, but if you risk to bend it, you definitely do something wrong. Yeah, the video hasn't crashed, it's just a still. Give me some time for explaining that. Now you can see I've used a zip tie to zip the brake caliper on the suspension. Onto the suspension, I should say. Be a bit careful there to not bend the hoses that much. Yeah, they don't like bending on tight radial. Something here, and I actually don't know what I'm explaining, but yeah, I'm sure it's interesting, very interesting indeed. I might need to cut this clip out, I'm not sure. I probably need to cut this clip. Yeah, it's a really nice brake caliper. Now, the next step, I think, is to remove the brake pads. They are stuck in the brake pad page. And you do that with your pipe wrench. By just grabbing them and wiggling them a bit. And eventually they come free. Can see in a few seconds these pads were actually not that worn, but on the other side we had the brakes rusted on, and while accelerating made a big crack, and we actually split a brake pad, and after a short while not noticing this, we got a message on the screen saying to remove or to exchange the rear brakes. These are the two E18 bolts that hold on the brake cage. They are the hardest bolts to remove, and we use our breaker bar. You're gonna see that in a second. This is the E18 socket, and we push that on with a C-clamp to not have it slip off, because it's fairly loose. You can see the C-clamp holding on the socket and the breaker bar, and now you hit the breaker bar from underneath and that turns the socket, even if it doesn't want to turn, without having an impact driver. An impact driver is fairly hard to fit in that space. It's not that much space, I think, but yeah. Hit the thing and eventually it's gonna come loose. If you're really strong, you can do it by hand, I think, but I can't, and yeah, it's quite a struggle. If you can go underneath the car, it's easier. So now I've removed both of them with the same method, and you can wiggle out the brake cage. And with the brake cage, you actually need to do a bit of preparation, and that's to clean the surfaces I now point at. On these surfaces, the brake pad sort of slides on, and they should be shiny. Sort of shiny with the ones I point at now. In the next shot, you're gonna see me using the wire brush to first brush off the coarse dirt or rust from the cage, and afterwards I'm gonna use a file. You maybe want to wear breathing protection here. Brake pads and brake pad dust is probably not the nicest thing to breathe in, and that's probably what's on there. And again, don't look at the workbench. Just don't do it. Look at the nice clean surfaces here. You also need to clean up when you do your rear brake disc brake change. They should be, yeah, sort of shiny. And you can test them by putting on the brake pad and sliding it a bit. And if it slides fairly nice, yeah, that's alright. In the next step, you're gonna see me wire brushing the axle to have it a bit easier to remove the disc from your disc brake. And by removing the disc, I just first persuaded it just with a hammer, but I think now it's actually the wrong way of doing it. You should definitely apply some lubrication. And there's also this one 6mm hex bolt that's used to hold on the brake. Disc brake. I've removed it now, and now I'm gonna hit it with the hammer. And by hitting it with the hammer, I actually split or cracked the disc of the disc brake. That's no problem, because if you exchange the brake pads, you should also exchange the disc brake, because the surfaces wear in on each other. But as you can see here, with one of the first punches, it was a really light punch at this point. It's already cracked at the center. If you watch it really closely, you can see the disc part vibrate and the axle part stays super still. and you can see it closer here. Now I'm standing and actually exerting a lot more force, and in a short while my father is gonna stop me because he noticed that the disc brake was breaking. And then we applied some WD-40 in the holes for the lug nuts and around the axle, and let that soak in for about 10 minutes. And then I hit it very lightly and it just came off. After this, you for sure need to clean your axle or wheel hub and the lug nut holes. There you can see the crack that formed by me hitting it, or that got bigger while me hitting it. I don't actually know. You can see I wetted it 2 times with WD-40 there. If it wouldn't come off now, I would try to heat it with a blowtorch and making sure the wheel bearings and the axle stay cool-ish. With electric cars you sometimes can have these problems because you don't need to exchange your brakes that often. This car is now 7 years old and this wear is the first brake change that it goes through in its lifetime. So it's quite long. If they would be stainless steel, there would be probably minimal wear. I guess it rusts and then you brake and then the rust wears off and then it rusts again. The brake surface is really rough at this point. So I guess having stuck brake discs is quite a common thing. Or it's gonna be quite a common thing if there are more electric cars around. Now you can see I've removed it. I didn't expect it to remove, to go off that quickly. I just tapped it lightly with the hammer after applying the WD-40 and it came off. So yeah, that's great. And now comes the part where you apply your brake cleaner to hopefully remove all the WD-40, because you especially want the lug nuts to be super tight, or 140 newton meters tight. After this, you're gonna need to clean up your hub, and I do it with a wire brush on a drill, and that works alright. After this, you're gonna need a bit of sandpaper to clean it up a bit further to not have it rust back onto your new disc brake. After you get a nice shiny surface everywhere, you're done with this part of the repair. From then on, it's basically a straight reassembling in reverse order. You need to apply a bit of lubrication on some parts. I'm gonna go over that when we come to that part in the video. As you see now, there are a few more scratches in there. They come from the sandpaper, and basically the surface is nice and shiny, as it should be. Now you're gonna use your high temperature anti-corrosive or anti-stick compound. We used one from Liquimolly, and it contains copper, but there are also some species of this compound that don't contain any metal. I think they are even better. You don't risk of having a galvanic corrosion then. I applied a bit much here. I noticed this later and took a bit off with a towel. But generally, this is quite a satisfying task to do. Be aware to don't smear it into the threads for your lug nuts again, because you want them sticking and not coming loose after you tighten them up. As you can see, I now smeared it all in. Now I'm putting on the new brake disc. And aligning it with the locating hole and then screwing a new screw in. Sometimes these screws are supplied with your new brake disc, sometimes these aren't. As I mentioned, it's 6mm hex. So the next part is to reapply or to apply some of the same anti-seize compound to your brake pad cage and I'm gonna show you the brake pad cage now with the compound on it. By the way, be aware this compound is, don't get it on yourself. These bolts are sort of easy, sort of annoying to get in, but it's doable. And then after you got your thing on there, you're just tightening them up as hard as you can. Should be alright. I don't know. Maybe there is a torque spec for them. Maybe I can't reach that torque spec in that small space. Yeah, I'm gonna Google it, but for now it's gonna be alright. Just tightening them as hard as you can. I tightened them even more, as you see in the video. Oh, in the back you can see the piece of wood I put underneath the car for safety. These are the brake pads, the new brake pads, don't use your old ones. The one with the spring is the one in the back, the one without the spring is the one in the front. You now take off your brake caliper from your spring by cutting the zip tie with your combination pliers and you slide it onto the brake pads. Here are the two pins I've cleaned up, and shortly you're gonna see one where the anti-seize compound is applied to it. You can apply it fairly generously here, it's not a problem. And now the whole thing is mounted. Also, these can be torqued up as hard as you can, they're gonna bottom out. and then you're mostly done. That's most of the repair done. Then you just need to put back your small plastic plugs on the end. And after this, it's only putting back your wheel. Oh no, I forgot, there's the anti-vibration spring. As you can see, this is a new one. You first align it at the lower part, push in the first hook, and then you apply, then you will align it at the upper part, push it down there, so it's on there, and then you press in the middle and push in the upper hook. I'm gonna go over it again in a short while. First the lower part, upper part, and then push in the hook in the middle that still sticks out. Yeah, after this you're only gonna need to remount the wheel. As I mentioned before, it's 140 newton meters. Go around in a star configuration on the lug nuts. That's it. You're basically done. And saved a lot of money probably doing it.